Siobhan McNamara. Shimon's here, so I'm going to pass it over to Shimon. He's going to talk about lease options and estimated delay completion. So, put your hands together for Shimon.
Good evening. So, who's Shimon Rudich? For those of you that don't know me, first of all, I'm a solicitor. Not that it's the most important thing, but that is how I started my career with the professional world. Until then, I guess, students. Started as a lawyer in a place called Hull. Halfway to Hull, coming from Manchester, and I actually like Hull very much. I just didn't like my job. I used to crime. I didn't like my clients. I moved into property. I still have the same clients. but that is how I started my career as a solicitor. Accidentally started also my career as an investor then in Hull. I bought my first property in Hull. I was still a trainee solicitor. I was as green, back then, there weren't people teaching courses and things like that, so it was trial and terror, and you learn with mistakes. The clever man learns from his mistakes, the more clever, the one more clever learns from some other people's mistakes. That is where I started to teach eventually. When I sold that property a few years later, and only because we relocated from Hull to Manchester and I couldn't manage it myself, I made more money for that single sale than any given year as a solicitor. So that was my first hint that perhaps money is not in being a solicitor. And then eventually I bought more properties. Some by myself, other a joint venture, I like a joint venture. I'm also a property educator. I've been now teaching for 8 years. I've been lecturing in England and abroad. I have several thousand students around the country. I like teaching. I wrote manuals, articles. I mentor on a little bit because I don't have much time. I like to change people's lives. I also like to make money from other businesses besides property because it's the clever things to do. You often hear business gurus both here in the States saying that multiple source of passive income. Have you ever heard that? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Do you do that? Who does multiple source of passive income? Let me explain it before you raise your hands. Multiple source of passive income doesn't mean having many houses. But that is only one source of income, okay? Multiple source of passive income meaning having income from different industries, passively. So you have your property business, and then you have your pharmacy business online, and then you have your shoe business online, anything like that. Does that make sense? So if in 1 year property doesn't do so great, let's say the government decides to pass some crazy tax laws, you know. Then, who cares? I'm not making so great this year with property, but you know, even if I have to wait 2-3 years before the government realizes that I'm doing a big mistake, I don't care because I have my shoe business, I have my pharmaceutical business. So, ask, does that make sense?
Yeah.
How many of you do that? You see? 4 people. It's not a great percentage, is it?
Yeah.
So every 2 years, with one business partner that I have in Birmingham, I have business partners in different businesses. We start new businesses. Some of them work, some don't. And the if it doesn't make me decent money within 2 years, it's not worth my time. I'm also a charity fundraiser for the simple reason that I benefit from charities. You see me now as a successful property investor, solicitor. I have 2 law firms. When I came in this country 23 years ago, I didn't have a penny. I didn't even have the money for the bus. So I used to go from Salford to Manchester University. know Manchester, when it's not raining, it's snowing, so it wasn't fun. I used to live in a place that didn't even have a bath. There was a bath, but green wasn't the original color. So I had to get friendly with the guy who was running the local public bathhouse near my where I was living, so I could have a shower every night when I was used to back home. Perhaps he would have called it an HMO, because it was me and maybe a dozen pigeons there, right? So I had to get rid of the pigeons when I got there. Situation has changed. I don't bike anymore. I also put a bit of weight, as you can notice. But I haven't forgotten where I came from, so first I started to help pay charities that have me. And then 11 years ago, I started to actually actively helping them, one charity. So every year for a week, I go around fundraising for a charity. The first year, I think, we raised £26,000. So I got the job for life, as you can imagine. And we made, I think, in 11 years, just short of £100,000. I like it. Forgot to mention the most important part, it's not there. Happily married, 8 kids. And so you understand why I need a lot of businesses. 8 kids is almost as expensive as the wife. So now, because it is to this program, I'm going to teach you more information than you can retain, not just because I have much more knowledge than you, but because the area that I'm going to show you has a lot of information that you need to know in order to succeed. The aim is that you understand that you know nothing, in the nicest possible way, and that you take action to try to learn so you can do the same thing you do. I mean, don't tell me wrong, I'm not expecting everybody to succeed. Like, I'm not expecting everybody to be landlords. There is a reason why the majority of people are employees and only a little minorities are entrepreneurs. There is a reason why the majority of people are tenants and only a minority of people are landlords. And there is a reason why a lot of people go to networking events, but only few succeed. It's up to you to take the conclusion and take action. Now, let me ask you a first question. Who wants to become a millionaire by the end of the month without having to spend any money, time, efforts? Anyone? Wake up! Is that going to happen?
No.
But it doesn't matter what industry or trade or business you are, you will always find people telling you, buy this gadget, buy this course, buy this book, buy this machine, buy this laptop, whatever, and I can guarantee you, you will make money. Am I wrong? Now, I'm not telling you not to invest in yourself. On the contrary, if you don't invest in yourself, you will never go anywhere. Because any business based on this form of knowledge will not take you very far. But it's important that A, you get the right knowledge, and B, that you use it. Do you know what are the three fundamental steps necessary to succeed? I give you 5 seconds, by all means write them down, and then we see at the end of the evening if you get them right. Shall we? 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Let me give you a hint before I forget, actually, regarding success. I remember when the first property networking event I went to in Manchester, I already had my own law firm, I already was double digit with properties, and I was surprised when networking went to property. I went there, and after already a couple of times I was there, people realized that I knew more than people there. So people used to always come and ask me questions. And there was one guy in particular who used to come every month. And every month he used to come and ask me a couple of questions. So after 6 months I went, okay buddy, have you bought anything? And guess it's not Shimon. I said, why not? Oh, Shimon, I can't afford to give up on my day job. Who said that you had to give up on your day job? 90% of us start in property on the side. We are like superheroes, right? During the day, we are Clark Kent in an office. At night, you put your costume, you do your due diligence. You now, what do you do in the evening? Oh, but you know, I work hard. I come back home. I prepare my tea. I sit in front of the telly. And then eventually, I pass out. Okay? Weekends, you know, working weekends, I do. So, oh, Shimon, at least weekends, let me spend my time and out. Either I go to watch Man United or I go to the pub with my mates. I knew then and there that this guy will never ever succeed. Because doesn't matter how much we learn. Not that networking events is enough to learn, But we never succeed because something serious was missing there.
Action.
You think I was wrong? The proof is in the pudding. 2 years ago, I met him again. That was 6 years after the, I met him the first time. In Leeds. Funny enough. And he told me, he came to me and says, oh, like a lot of people came after the talking. Shimon, I want you to mentor me. I was like, whoa, what that is. Now, you don't want to be rude to people, say no. But at the end of the day, I only mentor a few people. And there's no point mentoring someone who they don't succeed. So one of my very few skills is that I think fast. So I knew what was the problem. I said, okay, do this for me and email me. I gave him a task that wouldn't take him more than 5 minutes. 2 years later, I'm still waiting for the email. Does it make sense?
Yeah.
There is option, definition. It's the right, but not the obligation to buy a property. So you have the right to buy number 13 marketplace, say for £100,000. You will have the right to buy it within the next 6 months, 6 years, or 16 years. You will have the right to occupy it, to or either for yourself, in case you cannot afford a luxury house, or to put tenants with a view to make money from the tenants. With rights comes obligations. So you pay the vendor that you pay his mortgage or a fixed amount of money every month. You will say that maintenance is on you and various other things. So you tell the vendor, no, tenants pays or not, I still pay your mortgage, roof leaks is on me, boilers get stolen, it's on me. If you never had the boiler stolen, you're not a landlord. And so on and so forth. Can you see why it's so good? Anyone? Anyone awake? Guys, it's an interactive session. I ask the questions, you answer. If you don't, Joe will kick you out. Simply because it's bigger than you, right? And so let me ask a question again. Can you see why is it good?
Yes.
And why? All together, raise hands, please. You don't have to put any money down, no deposit, anything else?
You don't have to need a mortgage.
You don't need a mortgage, no? You don't have to fight to get a mortgage. You don't have to fight with the surveyor for the right valuation. Does it happen to you sometimes? They come to a stupid valuation. Any other advantage?
You don't have to do it if you choose not to.
You don't have to do it. If in 6 years' time, the council decides to build a nice skipyard there, the value of the property is not going to appraise it. Now, if you bought it, now you're stuck with the landlord. If you have it, it's up, you say, sorry, mate. Cannot complain because, buddy, I didn't put the skip there yet. Take with the counselor. What else is so good? Who has watched Back to the Future?
Yeah.
Can you see the similarities?
No.
Me and Michael J. Fox? Okay, let me give you an example. So, Zev goes to Lizzie, just because I'm old, so I can read all names on the first one. Actually, I can see also the second. Said, Lizzie, my friend, I have this property that is worth £100,000 and you can have it for £80,000. Before saying yes or no, Lizzie, what are you going to do? It's not a tricky question, I'll answer it.
I would say yes straight away.
You will say yes straight away? Will everybody say yes straight away? Shiv, what will you do?
You did it.
I'm sorry, you said. For those of you like Lizzie, they buy properties without you, they didn't just. This is my email address, I have properties for you. On a more serious note, I forgot my business card. That is my email address. If you want to get in touch, whether you want to learn these options or use my law firm, that is my email address. So, as a property investor, so I would say that professional property investor, you have to have two levels of due diligence. The first level, 5 minutes. Shouldn't take you more than 5 minutes just to see if it's worth to you spending time there. Now, if there is any merits on the property. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So in 5 minutes, if you know what you're doing, you have your own websites, and you check value of the property, how many properties on the market, how long does it take the property to sell, rental value, demand, etc. Do you do that?
Yeah.
So if you do that, it must have happened to you at least once or twice, that the same property you're trying to buy now, or the one next to it, or the one after, was sold, say, 5 years ago, half the price, £40,000. Ah! I wish I started investing 5 years ago. Did you ever do that?
Yeah.
Well, you don't need to get upset, because you have your trial machine in the garage. So you go back in the past, of course, before Mr. Jones sold it, so 5 years and 1 month, You knock a door on Mr. Jones. I say, Mr. Jones, I know you want £40,000. Shall we say 45? Do you think at this stage you have a captive audience?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, let's do it. So I'm going to say, well, Mr. Jones, there is a little catch. There's always a catch, right? You're unmarried. And Mr. Jones, banks are not lending. No? It's true, right? If you've been in the game as long as me, you remember that before the last market crash, there were like over 100 mortgage products. They're both best mortgage brokers, or those I could remember all of them. Now there may be a dozen. But don't worry, Mr. Jones, until I don't come with the money, all your expenses are on me. How many times do you want me to pay your mortgage? Well, the way the guy says, as long as possible, right? Now, don't get me wrong. Not all the Mr. Jones out there are going to say yes. There aren't. But when you try to buy property discount and you offer 80% on the value or 70% on the value, do they all say yes? It's a numbers game, right?
Yeah.
Same thing here. It's a numbers game. If you say yes, fine. If he says no, you go to the next one, then the next one. What do you care? Petrol, the time machine is free. And once you find someone to say yes, you come back to the future. Hey, Mr. Jones, yeah, you made me £45,000. I'm sorry, I know you were trying to sell it at 80. But do you realize what you bought the property for? 55% discount? Do you think that 55% discount is just about right? Yeah? No. How stingy you're getting it. You want even more? And that is what you do. That is what I call a vanilla option. Something that every man and his dog can teach on stage about. You get an option, the property, you wait a few years, eventually properties in this country always go up. And also, it's not going like this, it goes down, up, down, down, eventually. Over a 10-year period, they always double, more or less. But not all vendors will agree on a 10-year option, do they? Mm. Say, what? 10 years? Out. Out! So if they don't agree on 10 years, what do? You give up, you let the deal pass, you see the money floating away out of the window. Wouldn't, besides, even if the vendor is agreeing to wait 10 years, would it make more sense if you learn how to make money within 6 months instead of 10 years? So why do people that teach lease options tell you to get lease options as long as possible? A, will reduce your chances to close the deal, and B, you're postponing making money. Not very clever, is it? Unfortunately, a lot of people that teach have either no teaching skills, or they're very good in the theory, but in the practice, they are not out there doing the deals. So would you like to see how to make money with credit strategy, advanced credit strategy, quicker? Yeah? The first strategy I'm going to show you tonight is the ugly duckling. So you have this house. What do you think is missing here?
Kitchen.
House without the kitchen means what? No mortgageable. So you have a property that is no mortgageable, 3 kids only. Belongs to grandpa, left it to them, and they couldn't shift it. There was a mortgage of £40,000, and they couldn't get any offer over 40. The property was on the market for almost a year and was going nowhere. I think the high offer they had was 35. Do you think that if I offer them £45,000, they will be interested?
Yeah.
Do you think if I tell them 10 years, they will be interested?
No.
The kids, they want money now. They need to spend their money for their beers and their iPhones. I mean, I say kids, but they were in late 20s, and you know, I'm just jealous about the age. Do you think that if I ask them now 6 months after they've been on the market for 11 months and going nowhere, they'll be more amenable?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
£10,000 more than higher offer they had so far. So, how much is it going to cost me to put a new kitchen, paint and carpet a 2-bedroom house? More or less?
Three grand.
Yeah?
You're
not allowed to answer because you're so speaking at least six times. And £3,000, I don't even need 6 months to flip it, do I? Because how long is it going to take me to repaint the carpet and put a kitchen in a 2-bedroom house? Maximum. Got it at 45, spent £3,000, resell it to 75. How much is my profit? Sorry? Less three. £27,000? Good result?
Yeah.
Now, don't tell me wrong. You can do it in a normal way without these options. You buy, you do it up, and you sell it, right?
Yeah.
What's the difference? First difference, if you do it in the normal way, you need £45,000.
Yeah.
If you do it my way, you need three.
Yeah.
Now, I now look in your pockets. Let's say that you have £50,000 in your pockets. And you do it in the normal way. And then 2 weeks later, you get another deal like this. What do you do? You look Mr. Truk in your left pocket. Let's say that in your left pocket you find another £50,000 and you do another like this. And then another 3 weeks and you find another deal like this. Because you should be very active and do things, alright? What do you do? Start looking in your jacket. Do you understand what I'm talking about? If you, unless you're Manchester City owners, money eventually ends. So if you only have £50,000 in your bank account, you can do either in the normal way, one property per time, or in my way, and it's 16 of them per time. Which one is better?
Yes.
Also, if you buy in the normal way and then you resell it, let's say it took you 1 month to do it up. Can you resell it right away?
No.
No, why not? Six months rules.
6 months.
The buyer cannot buy it with the mortgage until you own it for 6 months. If I do this option, I don't have to wait 6 months to sell it, because the property is not in my name, nor will ever be in my name. Better?
Yeah.
It's also better from a tax point of view if you do it right away, but it's because if you flip it, it's income tax. If you do your job properly, it's 40%. While if you do this option, it's capital gain tax if you do it the right way, which potentially is half. Do you think there are properties that are mortgageable in Leeds as well? Yeah? So how many have you done? All of a sudden, sorry. Why? You know why? Because you are transporting guys. These are out there, and you do nothing with them. I hear people tell me, I don't find deals. There are no deals anymore. It was easier in the old days, Shimon. There are plenty of deals out there. But you're transporting. The trains are passing in front of you. So far, so good?
Yeah.
Ask me a question at the end.
I'll forget. Okay.
Sorry?
I'll forget. It's relevant.
Okay, go on.
Sorry. So you've agreed... what you've agreed,
yeah,
giving the vendor £10,000 more, and you've sold it for 75.
Yes.
How did you get them to sign the contract and transfer at the end?
They signed it at the beginning.
Right, but you haven't got a price.
You don't have to have the signed transfer and price. You have a blanket. You can have the price after. There are technical questions. In all honesty, if you ask technical questions, guys, I mean, I don't mind.
Sorry.
But I don't mind. I have the answers. It just will take forever. It won't let me, so you will miss some of the strategies. You want more strategies?
Yes.
Yeah? Yeah. Six people say yes. The others can leave now. You want more strategies?
Yes.
Thank you. This is the slice and dice. So we have here a four-bedroom, semi-attached, Victorian, double bayfront property. Here the vendor was... an accidental landlord, bought a couple of properties. It was just someone with a very well-paid job. And he had the same tenant here for 6 years, family with six kids. When they moved out, the property is what they call entire, meaning it means they've done everything. The painting, the carpeting, the kitchen, and the tiling. He went to a normal builder. He quoted him like something like £15,000. Not being an investor, didn't put money aside, didn't have it. So he thought, okay, I'll put it on the market. The property is once done up, is worth £200,000. So he's asking now £200,000 before doing it up. Reasonable? Realistic?
No.
But I thought, if I find a need willing to pay, good. If not, after 3 months, because he was getting paid very well in his job, I will have money to start the works. Do you think he found an idiot?
No.
Yeah, he found an idiot. What do you think I did with this property? Anyone? Converted in?
Flat.
Yeah, absolutely. How many flats? Four flats. That I gave you two hints, guys. Hint number one is the description of the property. And hint number two is the title of the slice and dice. What do you think I'm talking about? Domino pizza? These properties, when I describe you, they're all the same. A double bay windows, door in the middle, corridor in the middle, 2 rooms at the front, 2 rooms at the back, and the same upstairs. So it's not that difficult to put a flat on the right, a flat on the left, in the same upstairs. Because A, is important how much space you have, and B, what is the structure of the building. Because if the building doesn't accommodate splitting, in order to make it, it becomes very expensive. Let me give you the obvious example of the reverse. Try to visualize a four-bedroom ex-council house. Can you visualize it? Mm-hmm. Can you split it for flats? No. The door usually is not in the middle. Even if it is in the middle, you don't have a long corridor splitting the property because ex-council house space is max and you use it max. So you don't have corridors and landings. You have the foyer and the entrance. From there you go to the lounge. From the lounge you go in the kitchen, on the dining room. From the dining room you go in the kitchen. The staircase is never in the middle, just going up. It will either start on the side and go in the middle, or it starts in there and it turns halfway through. So you have to move the staircase, all expenses. How much does it cost me to convert this one in four flats? More or less.
25, 30.
I would say around 40. 35, 40. Got valuation for each flat over just over 100. We sold it for 85, 85, 85, 75. Two tips here. Tips number one, attention, because these are tips that you get only from people that actually do the tips, okay? Not people that go on stage and they talk about fantasy island strategies. When person says, convert the flat is worth £100,000 and I sold it for £100,000, either it's London or it's bullshit to you. Because if you have something that is just an app and you want to sell it quickly, because you cannot wait 6 months, A, stupid, and B, you don't have months and months, it's not yours. You have to sell them at discount. Tip number two, you have three buyers and you still want to sell, you want to do them all in one go. Yeah. You give another further discount, you move on because time is money and you want to move to the next project. £10,000 is nothing. Why? Because 85, 85, and 85, and 75, how much is that? 330. Less £200,000 on the purchase price, less £40,000 on the refurbishment, £90,000. Good result?
Yeah.
How can I increase my £90,000 profit for even more? What else can I do here? I know, you saw me talking shit.
I know the answer.
Anyone?
Sell a freehold.
Selling the freehold, absolutely. How much can I sell the freehold for?
10% of the ground rent.
10 times the ground rent. Yeah. Usually, something like that. So here, 10, 15. If you put in an auction in London, you sell it for minimum 10%, usually 15. For the simple reason, because it's considered a great investment for anyone that likes to buy cash. Because no leaseholder is going to risk not paying the ground rent and losing his £100,000 flat. It's not that it's an eviction here, they lose the flat. So since we drafted the lease, the leaseholds, we thought it was fair that each leaseholder should pay £250 every year, which is £1,000 a year. So you can sell here the freehold usually around £15,000, which makes your profit from £90,000 to over 100. Simple tip, six-digit figure is always better than five-digit figure when it comes to profits. Yes?
Yeah.
Do you think there are four bedroom between houses also in Leeds? Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So how many of them have you converted? Can you hear it? Choof, 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 choof. You are train spotting, guys. There are plenty of these out there. The problem is that you don't know what you're doing. You need to learn. It's simple. You like, do you know how to fly an airplane? No. Would you like to do it? Yes. Have you done anything about it? Did you like this?
Yeah.
You want more?
Yes.
This is what I call an impossible deal. So here you have a three bedroom and terrace. There is a game of work here, sorry. I'm a rubbish photographer. And ex-council, can you see from the big work? House. Vendor wanted £51,000. Property was worth best at 60. I'm not spending £51,000 for the property worth 60, right? This is East Manchester. And, but have you noticed so far, I never care how much the vendor wants. Did you notice? When you buy properties the normal way, and you want a discount, what you do, you think you're just playing and negotiating a price. In reality, you're browbeating the vendor on the price. Do you enjoy doing that? Do you realize that when you buy properties discount, the vendor resents you? He thinks you took advantage of his situations, you took advantage of the economy, you took advantage of his divorce, you took advantage of his losing a job, you took advantage of his family bereavement or whatever. It might be not true you took advantage, but they believe that. Do you like that?
No.
Well, I don't need to do that. I actually offer those vendors. You choose the price, I choose the terms. As long as the price is reasonable, look. Remember the guy wanted £200,000? The price was not worth £200,000. I still gave him. If he wouldn't ask you £220,000, would that be outrageous? Absolutely. I will still pay £220,000 because we're still making money for me. So, will I pay cash £51,000 here? No. But in theory, I can do a lease option maybe here. But what do I do with this property? Can I make it to flats?
No.
No. Row ex-council houses, majority of them still belongs to the council. Council will never give me permission here. Can I make an HMO? Not really. There are three bedrooms upstairs. There is only one lounge downstairs. And these ex-council houses, as you know, the third bedroom is a shoebox. You put the cot. Usually, you don't manage to put a bed. We are actually lucky in this case to manage to fit a bed wall to wall. But you couldn't put a wardrobe, let alone, not even a bedside table. The door even wouldn't open completely, only 45 degrees, and then you die for the bed. Now, if it's a room in Marble Arch, Kensington East, you still rent it for £300 a week, probably, but not in Manchester. So, not an HMO, there wasn't much land to think about redevelopment. So, there wasn't an angle, really. Besides, even if I want to do, first you have to find out why selling, because that is the most important thing. In order to structure a creative deal, you need to find out why vendors are selling, right? Because in order to do something that's beneficial to you, first you have to find how to make it beneficial to them. Vendors, they're not traders like some of you. They sell their houses because they have a problem or a need. And they believe that by selling the house, they address the problem or need. If you can address the problem or need without selling the house and doing a lease option, then everybody's happy. What was he selling? Because he was facing repossession. And why did he want £51,000? Because he had a first mortgage of £25,000, second mortgage of £26,000. Hence, he wanted 51. Once he told me that he was facing repossession, I knew that 51,000 will never be enough. Because people that face repossessions, or in debt in general, tend to have a nice strategy called the ostrich strategy. They stick their hand in the ground, all problems disappear. So they tend to forget arrears and things like that. £7,000 worth of arrears. There was other debts here and there, cancel to buy. In practice, it was in negative equity. But remember, I don't care how much I pay me in theory, but I still don't know what I'm doing with this property. So if I cannot convert it in other things, if I cannot do a short lease option to add value quickly, shall I go for a long lease option, a traditional vanilla 10-year lease option? Will you do that?
No.
Who says yes? Yes. Who says no?
No?
If you say no, why not? You cannot say no and no answering, it's too easy. Huh? Just rely on the fact that I'm very clever and they have a different solution. It's cheating. If you say no, you have to give me a different solution. If you don't go for a long 10 years lease option, why not? And what would you do? Christopher?
I'd probably just rent it out.
So you get, how you're going to get a lease option on the property?
I'd probably just buy it and rent it out.
Buy it?
Yeah.
You will pay £60,000 because with arrears and everything it's at least £60,000. You will pay £60,000 for a property worth £60,000.
But in 10 years
it'll be worth
more.
This is my email address, you know, remember that, don't forget to email me. You know, it's not worth more. The property is not in bad condition. I mean, to rent it, I had to repaint it in fairness. But, and there was some serious ugly, all fashion tiles on the floor in the lounge and kitchen, which we have covered, but it wasn't some serious stuff. So I'm not buying it. Anything else?
Maybe contact the mortgage company and see if you can structure some sort of offer with them.
Why would they? They're about to repossess it.
Yeah,
they will not.
They're going to repossess it in an auction. They're going to
the potential is, but that is not that is not his option. First, you have to decide: are we doing a lease option here, and for how long? So, who is going for 10 years lease option here? Normal villain lease option in 10 years time is worth twice as much. But for those one of you that says 10 years lease option, aren't you forgetting something? What piece of information you don't have yet? Sorry. Well, we have 10 years to think what you're doing. You just rent it out. There is a different, different piece of information you don't have. Before you promise the vendor that for the next 10 years you're going to pay his mortgage, do you want to know how much is his mortgage first? For those of you that are willing to pay other people's mortgages without checking how much they are, this is my email address. Case in hand. Here, the first mortgage was £306 per month. The second was £660. And in East London, in East Manchester, this is open show. For those of you that are from Holland, Manchester, 7 years ago, six years ago, I think, if you rent it to DSS, you get more. And DSS for three beds was 620. Now it's back to 595. So if you do a 10 years lease option, you will be losing £346 every month. Great! Who wants this deal? First person gets it for £5,000. Can I make a bit of a deal? First two people for £3,000. No, I cannot say it to us, right? You will regret it. Why? You know this person who says he can, who says he can't, and use you both, right? Success is first year. If you don't think you can succeed, you will die. You will never succeed. And face this scenario, all of you will say, sorry, mate, can't help you. Because you don't know other ways of doing things. You still need to learn creative strategies. So what do you think I did here? The mortgage payments, so capital repayment mortgage. So I convinced the lender to go from capital repayments to interest only. So instead of paying 306, it became 61. Instead of paying 660, it became 132. Instead of paying 966 every month, it becomes 193. So we completely transferred the deal. Instead of losing 346, we are making 427. There's a difference, £773 every month. Without spending money to make it to flats, without spending money to making an HMO, just by using my brain. Good result?
Yeah.
And the guy didn't get it processed. Now, I'm not saying that it's easy. Actually, it's extremely difficult. It's difficult for me. They changed the rules about for banks whether they have to accept to go from capital to repayment from capital to interest only. So if it's difficult for me, admittedly, it's, let's say, more difficult for you, right? So if the lender doesn't agree to go from capital repayment to interest only, what do you do? Do you give up? Do you give up?
No.
So how do you fight? You fight the bank. This one we went through. But then we had another one where the second lender, not the first lender, the second lender wouldn't have been interest only. So the second doesn't go, it still doesn't work out. So we had, they were determined to go to court, which didn't make sense because there was no equity. They wouldn't reply to our letters, not me as a buyer. Officially I was the pro bono solicitor helping someone from stopping repossession, doing on a freebie because I have a great heart, which might be true, but it was my wife's company buying it, right? And nothing. They wouldn't entertain us. So 1 week before first hearing, I got a barrister to write to them and put, besides the defense, contemplate. So do you know how to fight banks? Do you know how to negotiate with banks?
No.
Do you know how to find the dirt behind banks? Because you have to find something to attack them, right? Well, the easiest and cheapest way is Google. Of course, you don't limit yourself to page 1, 2, or 3. You might have to go up to page 15. But they say that 99% of you never goes to page 15, right? You miss all the fun. So the second lender here was HSBC. But when I did my due diligence on the paperwork, I found out that when you originally took the loan out to the Chubby, was not with HSBC, but with the company called Financial Finance, which then changed name to HFC, and then HSBC bought them up. And when I did my due diligence on HSBC, I couldn't find anything useful against them on this matter. But when I did my due diligence on Beneficial Finance, I found out that at the time, they had a record, you know, like world record, something like that. they were the bank with the biggest fine from the FSA. Was still FSA then? No, they were the worst bank. Don't tell me wrong. Since then, a couple of banks beat them on that record. And the reason why they have this £2 million fine was because the FSA believed that they were lending money to homeowners without checking they could afford it, which was also the case of my chappie here. So in my defense to counterclaim, I said that. So do you know how to negotiate with the bank, by the way? Okay, let me ask you this simple, simple question. Have you, yes, more or less. Have you ever been to a bazaar, Marrakesh, Cairo, Istanbul, something like that? Yeah? Have you know how it works? You see the oranges or the t-shirt, you say how much they want, they tell you this, you want to pay this, so you start, okay, and then you meet somewhere in the middle, right? So here the lender wanted £33,000 for, I think it was £33,000 for the mortgage and the arrears. In my counterclaim, how much did they offer them?
Nothing.
I said zero. Why? Says restarting point zero, right? Said we don't think that you should get any money because your loan we don't think is valid. You never checked if you can we could afford to repay it. Do you think that I have the reason expectation to win in court?
No.
Anyone?
No.
No. But do you think I scared them now?
Yeah.
The day after, for the first time in 10 months, 9 months. Trying to argue and getting things from them, who never replied. But let me know, in those 9 months, I still put a tenant that was making money. Yeah? And not paying them a penny, not even the interest. Finally, they call us, and a partner in this law firm, and says, oh, we didn't realize you wanted to, you were going to fight it. We've been writing to you for 7 months, you know. Okay, what can I do for you, sir? Oh, will you agree for a week postponement on the first hearing? The first hearing is not a proper hearing, just directions, which was scheduled in 2 days' time, or 3 days' time. And we called and said, no. So, but we think that we can convince our client to settle out of court. So will you give us a week to discuss with our client? No. I said, well, we thought you wanted to settle out of court. You don't want to settle out of court?
Yes. Yeah.
Absolutely. I don't pay a barrister the cost 10 times more than a solicitor in any event. Says, I don't think I'm going to win. So why did I say no?
Haggling.
Guys, there is one thing that you have to learn when you do property. There are many things, but one of the things that you have to learn is negotiations. Many people think the negotiation is just a natural skill. You might have natural skills in negotiation, but there are many negotiation tactics that you should employ. We always teach, you know, higher authority, the neighbor. Here, one of my favorite strategies. You know that there are two forms of negotiation, amicable negotiation or hostile negotiation. When you're negotiating with the vendor, it's amicable. You sit next to him. You know, you put the arm around his back. When you are negotiating with the bank, it's hostile. There is a table between you two. Right? When you do hostile negotiation, it's like a war. You're fighting. What is the best book of war? Anyone?
Yeah,
absolutely. And rule number one is confuse the enemy. If you're close, make them think you're far. If you're big, make them think you're small. If I want to settle, make them think I don't. So no, I wanted to settle out of court. Now, we like to have our day in court. They don't know where I'm coming now. Now they're panicking because they don't have parameters. They don't know what I want. Of course I settle out of court. £30,000 instead of 33. 60% discount is good, right? I bought the cash, remortgaged within a couple of weeks. I even got more money than I spent in this property. Usually I just want whatever I spend because I want my money back. My money is like my Lego. I just wanted the same pieces that I start with. Because if I leave some pieces, then every time I build something, then I run out of pieces, right? But here was my way to say to the bank, that is a legal term officially. The vendor got didn't get repossessed. When you buy properties, they know. So first of all, great result.
Yeah.
But you know what is better than the money here? And often, you know, there used to be a commercial from Mastercard. I don't know, maybe there still is. I don't have a TV. And they used to say, for everything else, there is Mastercard. Mm. Meaning, there are things that are priceless. When you buy a house, do you have vendors to thank you?
No.
No? Do you get vendors every year to send you Xmas cards? No. You probably don't even know where they are now. This guy still thanks me after 5 years. Every year still calls me just to thank me about that at least once. 18 months ago he called me twice, the second time to tell me that his wife died, which was sad. She wasn't exactly young, but he's 15 years older than her, so it was a bit of a shock. But you know what's happening here? He believes on his friend that I helped him from getting possessed and going bankrupt. And to date, he still doesn't understand that I made money out of it. He doesn't understand how I can make money from a negative equity property. I often write on Facebook stories or strategies or information or tips for investors. And remember, once he wrote on Facebook on my saying, guys, listen to Shimon. 5 years ago, he sent me for repossession, just out of his good heart, without making any profit. So, what? No, Bobby, I made the money. I like to say that I did it just out of good heart. But it's, creative people like to achieve more than one thing with the same action, so then you can rest and do nothing. So here, I make the money, and I get also the gratitude. So far, so good?
Yeah.
Do you think there are negative property, negative equity in here in Leeds?
Yeah.
Properties facing repossession?
Yeah.
So how many of them have you done? Can you hear it? Two of two. Will you stop train spotting, guys? Isn't it about time that you learn what how to do these things? Next strategies, that is the storage millionaire. This is commercial deal. Just to show that it's not just residential properties. If you know what you're doing, you can make money from anything. The trick is to know what you're doing. So this is a place of brownfield in an area that decent area to build, but not worth building. Which is, for example, where I live, in the majority of Lancashire, I can buy properties cheaper than what it cost me to buy them, to build them. So even if I get the land for free, I wouldn't build. Because if it cost me like, I don't know, 60,000-70,000 pounds to build the house, but I can buy it for 40 or 50, why should I build it? Yeah? But the name of the game is to hold the land until the value goes up. Because land's banking, nothing new here, been around since the World. So why am I telling you about land's banking? Because the best way to do it is not to buy the property, is to get an option to the property, right? But this doesn't even cost you to hold it for the next 10 years or 5 years. So yeah, here a piece of land that is vendor wanted 200,000 pounds, probably is not worth 200,000 pounds. Nice location, but I won't build now. So I will get an option here. 10 years. I offer it even more than what he's asking. So let's say 220. And I promise also to pay money. I'm not promising to pay his mortgage because mortgage on a piece of land is probably nothing. Small, so offering to pay his mortgage is, you know, laughable. So I offer him £650 every month. So instead of him paying rates and vandalism or whatever, he's making money and he knows that he's going to sell it for more than what he wanted. So he's getting something that he's interested in, he's happy. Why is it good for me? What am I doing with this land for the next 10 years? Because I'm paying £650 a month. I'm not in the business of losing money. So what do I do with this land for the next 10 years?
Rent out storage.
Car park.
Yes, that's a different strategy. Here is the storage millionaire, so we put storage containers, right? You know what the storage containers are? Are the metal boxes at the back of lorries. Literally worth the weight. And then I rent them out. Do you know how much does it cost me, or any of you, to hide in bulk? Because you don't buy them, it's expensive, you hide them. So, each container, I can rent it for around £40 per month. So 50 is £2,000. I hire them out on an individual basis for £100 a month. So I make £5,000 for the hiring out, less the lease of £650, less the £2,000 of the rent, £2,350 every month, which is £28,200 every year, which is £282,000 after 10 years. Is that nice?
Yeah.
This is nothing compared to what I'm doing at the end. Because in the end, we calculate we can put 20 units between has a plus. Gross value of the project is £3 million. If I don't want to play Bob the Builder and dirty my head, and I just want to sell the land, how much do you think is the land worth, more or less? There is an easy rule of thumb among developers that says a third, and a third. I mean, if the value of the, a third is the